Now, our first guest this morning sees inflation falling to 3.8% this year, already within government's target range, the benchmark rate being cut by 100 basis points to 5.5%, GDP growth of 6%, and U.S. dollar-Philippine peso trading within 53 to 55 this year. For more on his market expectations and strategy, Sun Life's Investment Management's Richie Ryan-Teo joins us live. Hi, Richie. Good morning. Thank you so much for taking our call.
Hi, good morning.
All right, so your market outlook for 2024 is about painting the dragon and dotting the I's. Why don't you walk us through the key themes you see emerging this year?
Okay, thanks. So the key theme we're seeing right now, first and foremost, there would be rate cutting. So there will be cuts of rates, as you mentioned a while ago, 100 basis points. And because of these lower rates, that will drive better corporate earnings. GDP growth as well will be supported at 6%. And also the reason why we think that rate cuts will be coming is more of inflation having peaked already from last year. No? Mm-hmm. So we think it's going to return to normal. Of course, there will be risks like El Nino wage hike. But right now, seems like it's well on the path of going to the 3.8% that we forecasted for this year.
The 100 peso wage hike has already been approved by the lawmakers. How serious is this as an inflationary pressure?
Yeah, well, based on the numbers, based on our simulation, that can push back up inflation from the 3.8, it can go up to 5% if that really pushes through. So yes, in terms of the numbers, that will have an impact on inflation, and probably that will make policymakers pause a bit and see how it will really impact growth and inflation.
Mm-hmm. All right. Let's take a look at the returns you're seeing for this year. And what sort of allocations are you suggesting to clients? I think we do have a graphics of this. 2024 returns expectations for local equities.
Yeah, so for local equities, our house call is it will end at 7,200. That's our base case. So there, it's really backed by fundamentals, sentiment, and valuation. In terms of allocation that you've mentioned, given that we're seeing about 11 to 13% return for this year, although right now we've already seen about 6 to 7% since the index has performed really well, we still see some more upside. So we are still very constructive on this asset class. But not to be outdone would be on the fixed income, wherein because of those rate cuts, we also expect slightly lower, around 8 to 10% return for our fixed income markets.
Hmm. All right. And so what sort of allocation? Is it 30-30-30? Equities, fixed income, cash? Cash is still king for many.
Well, that will really depend on the risk appetite. Mm-hmm. So assuming your... Usually, I associate it with age also. But if ever you provide me a parameter, what we will usually do is we'll look at how much you can allocate to equities, and we'll try to really maximize that given our positive outlook. No? And also for fixed income, but of course, that would mean to say that cash will have a little less portion right now, no? As compared to the previous years, wherein cash is really king.
Mm-hmm. Well, you mentioned age. Is it still 100 minus your age? And whatever number you get, that's the percentage you assign to equities?
Yes, that's correct.
All right. Yeah. All right. Now, why don't you walk us through, you have a certain segment on your report about bluer skies earnings growth-wise. Because you did talk about improving corporate earnings numbers. So what sort of numbers are you expecting to see?
Yeah, thanks for that. So we're seeing, if you compare it last year, wherein we even saw some of the regions having negative EPS. For this year, we expect all will be posting positive. So that's why we are saying it's really more of blue skies. It's not similar to the 2021 story, wherein we really saw huge numbers, but that was really coming from the COVID. So because of the COVID, the negative returns, there's really a bounce back. But this time around, in 2024, we're seeing more healthier across all other sectors. So it's not just dominated by one. And this is really brought about by a better economic backdrop with lower rates already. You know? So it's not really on the tightening mode. And that will really help all of the corporates out there, not just here in the Philippines, but all of the regions. You can see there, Asia, Japan, US, Europe.
Richie, just curious, for those who are seeing this graph that we're flashing, for the year 2021, the Japan Topix Index, it's that yellow line that stands out very long. To what do you attribute that?
Yes, is that for the 2021 you mentioned?
2021, yes.
Yes. So, well, it came from 2020 sa very low.
It was a base effect.
Negative, yeah. It's a base effect. Of course, if you're down by 50%, you need 100% to really make up for it, right? So it's more of that. So that's why I try not to really look into 2021 and really see where on the normal years how they are performing. And I think right now, 2024 really paints a good picture now.
And would you say this 2024 expected returns and 2025, 2024 E and 2025 E, I'm looking at the blue lines here, that this is back to normal already? The normal trajectory for earnings growth?
Yes, that's correct. So we think that we will go back to where the averages were, no? So
All
as you
right.
can see here, yeah, there's a table there showing it's even higher because for MSCI Asia ex Japan, it's only at 5.4%. But given that we've seen a lot of property woes from China, we've seen two negative growth already out of that region. But
And
once we see those structural changes, we can see better numbers, even better than averages. But that's a big if right now.
all right, I'm looking at 2024 estimates. You're seeing MSCI Asia ex Japan at, let's see, nearly 30%. I think that's about 25% earnings growth. How will the Philippine compare? The Philippines.
Yeah.
Are
So
we
yeah.
higher,
So.
lower, at par with average for MSCI Asia ex Japan?
Yeah, our earnings forecast for the Philippines is about 9% growth. So that will be lower compared to that, to the region. But we think in terms of valuations, we are still one of the cheaper ones right now. We have a chart there also showing if you just compare it historically, there's still some compelling reason on why foreigners will also look into the Philippines, especially if they look into the basket, because we also need not just the Philippines to outperform, but we need the whole region. That's why if we look at rate cuts, that will benefit not only the developed markets, but also the emerging markets. And with that basket benefiting, we will also be floated now. But yes, it will be compared definitely.
But Richie, why are we underperforming? I mean, when MSCI Asia ex Japan on average will see about 25% growth, why is the Philippines expected to see just 9% growth? I mean, you did say we're cheap. Apparently, we are cheap for a reason, for good reason.
Yes, that's correct. So we think that, well, the 9%, that's based on our numbers on a company basis, on the PSEI composition. But in terms of outperformance, in terms of the market, that will really involve also the sentiment of the market and how the peso would be performing versus the rest of the region. So if we see peso strengthening, which we think right now, it will be more stable, unlike the previous years because of the rate hikes, it caused really peso and other emerging market currencies to depreciate, right? So once that stabilizes, that will see or that will invite more inflows at like what we've seen last month for our index, and that will really benefit. So I think we will need those the currency to be stable and to really improve the sentiment. And I think with more catalysts, especially within the Philippines, like for example, last week, sorry, wherein the NAIA PPP project was already awarded. I think that's a very good sign that the foreigners also will really latch into so that they can really look into the Philippines, because we really need that catalyst so that we can also, perform together with the market.
All
And
right.
maybe that weakness will revisit and going back to the 15 to 17 times PE.
Actually, I was going to ask you how much of your estimates and your assumptions are based or dependent on the return of foreign flows.
That's a huge factor, given that right now a lot of our local money, we're already invested because most are invested on the long-owned funds, right? So we would really need that additional new money that will come in. Because for the local funds, yes, we can still increase, especially if they are allocated in cash, but that can only do so much. So I think that's critical to have that new money come in.
Mm-hmm. Critical to have the new money come in. And where's that money going to come from?
That will come from other countries also, other fund managers, other real money out there.
Mm-hmm.
But it's been encouraging. I think if we also talk to our fellow brokers, to the broker servicing, I think they are receiving a lot of queries as well, a lot of interest, mainly because, yes, our earnings have been good. If you look at the pre-pandemic, our earnings are actually 15% higher pre-pandemic.
So this isn't just revenge spending anymore. The growth we're seeing, it's new kind of energy. All right. Final question. You did note a very interesting about the policy pivot we're expecting from central banks, from the Fed to the Banco Central. You did note that based on the last 5 easing cycles, the average number of months it usually takes from the last rate hike to the first rate cut is 8 months.
That's correct.
So when are you expecting the first cut to happen here in Manila? That would be...
Yeah. That, if we look at that numbers, that would be around May or June. But of course, it's just an average. Mm-hmm. So it can be plus minus that as well, though. But our forecast, internal forecast, it can start happening by the second half or at the earliest, late second quarter. But again, here, there's a lot of caveats because we would need to take a look at the risk, mm-hmm. how they are developing. And one critical factor also is, what will the Fed do? Because I don't see BSP hiking ahead of the Fed, because that will have a lot of dynamics, like
for the peso. Exactly.
Yes.
All right. On that note, Richie, thank you so much for joining us this morning and for the insights. Have a great weekend ahead.
You too. Thank you, Min.